Right, good morning everybody, and welcome to this session. The session's about trustee and consultants, behaviours and biases. So I hope a bit of soul searching this morning. Now I'm delighted to be joined by a panel. To my far right, I've got John Belgrove, who's a senior partner at Iain, Hewitt. To my right, Hannah Lewis, who is a founder of Behave London, and they focus on problem solving, which uses behavioural science. And to my left, Dr. Iain Clacher from Leeds University. Now, as we sit in this room, and we know the size of the assets being managed just by PLSA members, that's over £1 trillion, and we're responsible for 20,000 savers thinking about their retirement. We have a huge responsibility, and no doubt, in some way, whether you're a trustee or whether you're an advisor, you are connected to that governance process. Now, of course, it's not straightforward. You know, which asset manager should you select? What's the right investment strategy? What are the right decisions? They're so subjective. And of course, when we listened to Ed Balls yesterday, he talked about the importance of consensus, but he also shone a light on making sure we challenge the underlying assumptions. Now, this conference has been about diversity, and this session is about cognitive diversity. How does our conscious and unconscious bias influence our decision making? And with consultants attending most of our meetings, does groupthink and authority bias influence those decisions as well? So, a lot to think about. I hope we're going to have a really good debate. I hope that you're going to ask some really challenging questions. And for those of you that aren't in the room but would like to participate, you can use the PLSA app to give me your questions and I'll put them to the panel. So I'm going to start off with John, who I think is going to give a little bit about himself, as well as sort of explaining the concept and the relevance of this subject. Over to you, John.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Ruston, for that introduction, and good morning, everyone. It's a great-looking audience. I guess we're all going to behave ourselves, right? Okay. Look, I hope and expect that you come to this session with a range of views, that there will be some sceptics in the room that think all this behavioural stuff is a bit sort of crackpot pseudoscience, through to perhaps those that think our irrational humanness is what drives markets and explains the strange markets ups and downs. But I would guess that there is a sort of central population of folk who suspect there might be something in this for trustees, but thinking that the way we make decisions isn't broken, that investors are pretty rational, that markets are pretty efficient, and that boards, trustee boards, are not biased. Now, I would argue that the shape of market opinion on the importance of behavioural finance, behavioural economics, whatever you prefer to call it, has changed considerably in recent years. And I think the financial crisis really added to its credibility. So let me try and provide a bit of evidence for that point of view. If I can get through the slides. Just one moment. Technology lets me down. Here's an FT article from just over 7 years ago. It was actually January 2010. And the title is More Respect for Behavioural Studies. I really like that. The article then kind of bangs on about how we were all caught hopelessly off guard, that financial models didn't work, assumptions were askew, and we really need to understand risk in a totally different way, and that maybe behaviour holds the key. Let's look at another extract to this article, and basically this is saying that all this behavioural stuff is for academics in the classroom, and it's a far cry from the real world of professional management. Well, I guess that's a bit less encouraging for me. But soon after that comes what I like to think is the inspiration behind the piece's title, and that is this quote, that behavioural finance disciplines are likely to become more dominant, respected, and better developed in the coming decade. And remember, this was 7 years ago. So that sounds pretty good to me. And maybe it's turning out to be true. So I wonder who had this foresight. Blimey, it was me who said it. I really, it just goes to show, doesn't it, that you can say enough things in enough places and maybe one or two of them turn out to be semi-credible with hindsight. But look, let me pause for a moment. Do you see what I've done here? I've already exhibited a number of cracking biases just within my short introduction. I've slipped into confirmation bias. I've used a specific but pretty obscure bit of anecdotal evidence to conveniently support and anchor my argument and maybe lend myself a bit of credibility. But I'm not stopping there either. I'm into authority bias because, you see, I'm no expert in behavioural finance, but I can dress up to and talk as if I am one. My expertise, my training, my background, my experience is in the intersection of investment with pensions. And if we're going to be more specific about that, it's DB pensions. But behavioural psychologist, I am not. Armchair psychologist, now you're talking. I've got all the badges for armchair psychology. I enjoy that a lot. But since I've got the mic and since we're in this situation, I do risk authority bias and overconfidence bias is kicking in. Although I have to say that overconfidence is far from my usual feeling when I'm in this sort of position. But vulnerability and uncertainty doesn't sell so well in our industry, does it? I mean, more's the pity. I would like to see maybe one or two fund managers that say, well, I never saw that coming. I really can't explain it. Or actually, that's outside my area of expertise. But it might be refreshingly honest, but it probably isn't hired. Anyways, thankfully, we do have some folk in the room. So let me go back. We do have some folk in the room who do know plenty about this subject. And for my part, it's actually been more than a passing interest as well. But you won't necessarily know that yet. What I do know is that my 53 years of white male comfortable life experience, including 30 odd years of industry experience where I grew up with market cycles that had much higher bond yields and happy pension surpluses, could give me a whole bunch of biases and receive wisdoms to unleash as an advisor. And coincidentally, these features, and here I'm talking about age, gender, and ethnicity, these features make me the typical trustee. Not that I am one, but I'm bang on the average trustee profile, and perhaps more about that later from Iain. Recognising and distilling the biases that we inevitably bring to the table is something that I intend to argue is a powerful and important thing for boards to do. Something that we benefit by being more conscious about. Trustee boards contain a lot of forces for good, of course, but also contain a few traps for bad. If only we can just tame some of those traps. Oh, and by the way, hands up, if we can tame some of the traps for us as consultants as well. I thought that if we stood any chance of helping trustees around bias, then we better start with holding the mirror up to ourselves. So we sought outside help. We sought outside help from informed expert individuals with Hannah and her team of behavioural psychologists at Behave London and with Iain and his business school experts at Leeds. And we've begun a journey. And so I want to spend the next 10 minutes on some of what we've learned and done. It's actually changed the way that we work with clients and the way that we think. And so this is really a chance for me to share a snippet of that. And when I went too early on the slides before, just as a bit of context about behaviour and markets, in case you're all feeling kind of in the rational and efficient camp, I was looking back on 2016 and thinking that was a pretty quiet and uneventful year, wasn't it? I mean, here's a few images that kind of jog the memory, and I'm sure they're still very fresh in mind. But of course, big political events are very distracting. I mean, even when we know in advance exactly what the event is, we know the precise timing of it, we know there can only be one of two possible outcomes, they still cause all sorts of surprises, market wobbles, knee-jerk responses, even though in that very precise moment, nothing has actually changed. In uncertain times, sentiment or humanness outweighs cool, calculated analysis, and our many insecurities and our biases come to the fore. Whether we are fist-pumping the air in victory at the results, or whether we are running to the hills in fear, or whether we are just kind of ducking our heads a bit and sort of waiting for the dust to settle, we are reacting, but not in a practical way. We really struggle to look through the noise. And here's an important point. We especially struggle to benefit from the noise. It's easily said, I know. And 2017 has turned out to be much the same vein in terms of geopolitical uncertainty. But here's something really weird. The market reaction to all this has been, you know, kind of extraordinarily constructive and calm. I mean, seriously, let's pretend that you had a crystal ball halfway through last year and you knew all the political events that were about to unfold. Well, I'd have been tempted to kind of get clean out of risk assets and waited for calmness to return. Of course, if I'd have done that, that would have been an incredibly expensive decision. It would have proved very costly. So my key point is this, my key point, more than ever, sound decision-making processes and clear beliefs are needed to navigate the investment terrain. With Trump, Brexit, European elections, losing rock music legends, whatever gets thrown at us, my strong proposal to you is that this is an excellent time to check in with your natural biases and to use disciplined frameworks and processes to aid decision-taking and to consider new lenses and inputs applied to your established objectives. And to be fair, I think this is what Ed Balls was telling us yesterday. I think this is what Gillian Tett was saying. And there's even a component where I can link in Daniel Finkelstein's comments as well on this coming up. Don't get too comfortable with the status quo. Why should past decisions that have benefited us continue to hold good? And why should past things that have hurt us suddenly turn around and benefit us? So what I'm saying is apply fresh lenses, apply different points of view in the room, build robustness into your approach and prepare to be wrong. Let me talk about a different theme here. I mean, how do you take decisions ordinarily? We all take them, I suspect, in a variety of ways for different circumstances. And here are just some examples. Some approaches here may deliver more consistent outcomes than others, but sometimes the lesser trodden path yields the bigger benefit. As decision makers looking after pension schemes, you are often bombarded with ideas and challenges competing for your time and for your assets. So how do you prioritise and how do you choose? It's probably fair to say that an industry-wide starting point, particularly from a consulting angle, is often to look at some kind of modelled output. I mean, but we do it everywhere, economics as well, as Ed Balls was saying. And we say this or that will improve the risk and return of your portfolio and ideally both. And of course, it's predicated on a set of assumptions, and challenging the assumptions is a very important part of this. But as presented, it's designed to look and sound sensible, albeit in a particularly mathematical way. And such approaches usually assume that investors, yourselves, will take cold, rational decisions framed by the way the analysis is presented to you. And as consultants, we can be guilty of seeing things too narrowly and consequently not presenting everything fairly and cleanly or doing enough to really work hard to draw out the different viewpoints in the room. Instead, complexity and technicalities become our friends kind of thing, and they can sometimes dominate the narrative. The conversation's all about a technical picky point and we've lost the big picture. None of this, I think, is particularly by design. You know, it's more a case of being anchored to what we're used to, what we've culturally been brought up on. But then what happens? Then we get sideswiped by stuff that we're not conscious about. And this is behavioural economics in action. Emotions, biases, preconceptions, left-field insights, whatever you've read recently or seen on the TV can all lead to make us decisions less optimally and less predictably. Theory and instinct, of course, are age-old conflicts. And here I'm kind of veering into Daniel Kahneman's work. His famous book, Thinking Fast and Slow, is very good here. But you've got that easy way we make decisions, which is intuitive, instinctive, gut reaction, based on my experience, I know what I'm doing. And then there's the really hard way of making decisions, which is reflective and analytical and research-orientated and testing. And I'm not saying one's right and one's wrong, but they can run into conflict. And when that conflict exists, it creates for suboptimal decision taking. So we need to find ways to reconcile and explore these opportunities and threats more cleanly. We don't want to get taken necessarily by the loudest voice in the room. Appreciate when you've got a mic, you're obviously the loudest voice in the room. But anyway, let me move on. In our world of pensions, the word governance has rarely been far from the lips of many consultants for many years now, and the term, I suggest, has kind of lost its meaning through overuse. And I know for many of you, it is a massive turnoff. I've had that experience where I kind of use the G word and then, ooh. Anyway, behind it is a very serious subject of effective decision taking. As an industry, arguably with a heavy bias towards numerical analysis and conventional economic theory, we often try to explain everything, as I said, in numbers and models. And when the outcomes don't match the numbers, our folk can be, or some folk, let's say, can be pretty skilled at adapting the explanations and the emphasis to fit the outcomes. So how do we equip ourselves as a trustee board to call that behaviour out? We wanted to reach for the blank canvas and the first principles. And as I said, we sought help from behavioural specialists who actually interviewed our consultants. And yeah, spotted a few biases, which were quite eye-opening for us. And so we went back to the drawing board about how we bring ideas to the tables, to your tables. And one key development has been our viewpoints framework. And this has created a much more engaged client dialogue with a much wider range of client solution outcomes as a result, as it happens. Now, of course, it's not my purpose to describe that here today. Suffice to say, it has changed the way we work and interact with our clients, and the feedbacks continue to be really good. So we're encouraged by that. You know, it's kind of ringing a bell. Education, and more so overcoming our own inherent biases and received wisdoms by when we grew up and what we were used to, was a big part of the challenge that we faced. As consultants, I'm sorry for this, as consultants we still get excited about stochastic modelling. We think it's great. But the output serves no use if it leaves the recipient cold with indifference or confused with jargon. And I know that if we don't represent information clearly and fairly, and if we don't recognise our own biases and shortfalls in the modelling work, the assumptions perhaps, then we won't be effective for our clients. Understanding really truly only comes with looking at things through multiple perspectives. And I was encouraged again about the points being made about social media feeds. We need to get feeds of the points of view that are not our own in order to inform us, rather than reaffirm. For some time, I've been using this mantra with some of our specialists about less mass, more behaviour, please. And I get some confused looks. But now, really, where we've got to is we are seeing the advantages encouraging trustees to look at the problems through multiple lenses and shared experiences, not just conventional numerical analysis and not just one-way dissemination. Having mentioned viewpoints as a framework, I'll leave it to Hannah, I hope, to possibly say something about our simple but popular trustee checklist. Lots of versions up there. Daniel Finkelstein was going on about that quite a lot. Look, it's free, it's open for anyone to use and adapt. There's no kind of ownership about this. We selected Behave London to work with to develop the trustee checklist, and where we're working with Iain and his team at Leeds is really focusing around trustee effectiveness. And we've got so much more planned. In particular, we wanted to explore trustees' perceptions of understandings of costs and value, of investment risk and return, and manager selection, and the role that bias takes in all of those decisions. We also wanted to bring a more disciplined point about the real-world challenges that our clients actually want to solve. Smart ideas can be self-serving to the providers, right? We do know that. But there are just way too many smart ideas out there, if you kind of get my meaning. But they have to have clear relevance to the practical goals of trustees. However, this is a really, really important point. Trustees that shun all this inflow of new ideas, that shun it and hide behind the status quo thinking, may well be missing opportunities that they later come to regret. So it's important on you guys as trustees to be open-minded as well. We're using different numbers here, Ruston. I'm going to say 1.5 trillion of assets, and the importance of retirement outcomes on 20 million members, I would say, maybe 11 million, 20 million, in 11 million in the Green Paper, 20 million in PLSA. There's been relatively little research on the effectiveness of the trustee plus advisor decision-taking setup. There has, however, I'm going to be wrapping up. There has, however, been plenty of opinion and rhetoric and assertion about this. set now against the backdrop of the FCA's asset management market study and the pension regulator's 21st century trustee and governance work, our ongoing work led by Leeds University, I hope, will aim to bring evidence to support or inform these assertions that's out there. So in conclusion from me, I wanted to say, let me thank you for allowing me to share some of my biases with you. I'm encouraged that I'm seeing better awareness of the effects of our humanness on the logic of decision taking, for good and for bad, by the way. The chances of avoiding the behavioural traps that destroy value and expose us to bad risks are improving. But until the robots and the robo-advisors take over, we're still going to be working on the interplay of humanness with investment risk and reward. That's all from me. Thanks very much. Back to Ruston.
Right, thanks very much indeed, John. Now, I'm just going to ask a few questions of the panel, but it would be great to get some of your questions or even challenges. So, John, are you feeling a lot better? You seem to have offloaded all your biases. You might have just shared three, there might be more, who knows?
Therapy.
Clearly, we have huge responsibilities. We've got big decisions to make. We work as a team, as trustee governance boards. Hannah, John talked about a bit of research that you did on Aon's consultants, which seems a bit intriguing for me. I don't know if you can share some of that, but also maybe reflect on some of the points that John has made.
Okay. So the work that we did on the trustee checklist was we wanted to find a practical way to help you when you're sitting in a boardroom making decisions, because it's all very well to tell you that you're flawed and you make bad decisions without telling you how to counteract that. So we, as a goldfish bowl, we put a load of consultants in a room and we put a load of trustees in a room and we asked them a lot of behavioural questions. And what we did was to, we'd had a psychologist in the corner of the room actually observing their behaviour as well. So what we found is when you ask people questions, quite often when they agree quickly and move through a topic, it's because there's consensus on it, but it's also that it's a bias that they're actually all privy to. And so, for example, for trustees, we found that authority effect was very hard on them. They were really affected by it. And what that means is there's a tendency to listen to that big voice in the room, whether it's a strong chair or the consultant, and to roll with that person who appears to have the expertise, whether or not they actually do have that expertise. But as an outcome of the research, we then set a load of questions, both of normal people, normal financial questions, as opposed to kind of complicated DB questions, and then DB questions, which were tested on real life trustees, although no one was harmed in the making of the study. And as a result, we got six core biases, which John's got up on the screen, which we found really affected trustees. So the trustee checklist is about having a checklist to weigh against that behaviour and to have something that prompts you in the room when you're making those decisions to help you. Now, when we tested it, what we found is we gave half of the people that took the test the checklist and we gave half of them nothing, other than the questions. And we asked them to consider the checklist as they made their decisions. And as a result, everyone was just as confident that they got the answers right, whether they had a checklist or not, which I think is lovely. But the people who didn't have the checklist were making, you know, they were like 58% less biased decisions, and the ones with 71%. So we saw a really big uplift in just having that small break on behaviour. And it's a bit like, as John's talking about the system one, system two, or the fast and slow thinking. If you've ever walked down a broken escalator, you know it's broken, you walk down it, but still when you reach the bottom, you still stretch out your foot, waiting for it to move. And there's that moment where you click between, you know, your automatic thinking, you're just rolling down, and actually having to think about what you're doing. And that's all a checklist is. It's a break on behaviour. It's allowing you to kind of look at what you're doing automatically and maybe think about it again.
Hannah, just on that, so the checklist is great, but actually how do you integrate that type of thinking into meetings on an ongoing basis and make it quite natural?
Yeah, it's something that I'm very interested in. I think it's, it leaps using the authority effect, you'd want a strong chair to take that on board and use it, and encourage people around the table to do it. I'm very keen on the idea of a devil's advocate. Now, there's always a loudmouth in the room. You know, there's always that one person who pipes up. But the problem is letting the person who is the natural devil's advocate take that lead is dangerous, because maybe they do it 9 times out of 10, but the 10th time when you really needed them to, that's the one where they agree and they didn't. And if you're all agreeing all of the time, maybe that's problematic. So it's almost like appointing someone, you know, to wear that hat in the meeting and to question and challenge every decision to, so you get that diversity of thought.
And I guess the other key thing as well is, you know, the role of the chair is really important to make sure it's a discussion, a conversation, and everybody feels included in it. And I guess that as a trustee board, we look at sort of different levels of knowledge and skill sets and areas of knowledge as well to make sure as a team you can cover everything off.
Yeah, absolutely.
Acknowledging all of that. That's really helpful. And Iain, you've been doing some research. Can you tell us a little bit about that? And also, from your more academic perspective, it'd be great to hear your thoughts on John, not personally, but, you know, about the subject he was describing.
Yeah, so for the past 12 months, we've been working with Iain, looking at trustee decision-making across a whole range of issues, and sort of breaks up into three sort of main parts. So the first bit really said, well, what do trustees look like? So what is the average trustee? What does the average trustee board look like? Because that's quite important in trying to think about what might influence trustees in aggregate. And so we looked at issues around, say, diversity, so gender diversity and age diversity. So your typical trustee is a man who's 55 and has been doing it for 10 years. So there's not a lot of age diversity, there's not a lot of gender diversity, and that lack of cognitive diversity can be problematic and lead to the type of groupthink situation that Hannah's talking about. And we then started to say, well, from my side, I think there's a rhetoric out there about trustees being pretty poor at what they do, and there's a view that maybe the fund management industry tricks them on a regular basis. And so we started to look into that. So we said, well, what's the sort of level of financial literacy of trustees compared to the general population? And unsurprisingly, trustees are better than the general population, but I think providing an evidence base for that and a substantial evidence base for that is quite important. We also then started to ask a little bit more around sort of costs and fees, because if you look at the FCA report, and you look at the direction of travel, then we're saying, well, explicit and implicit costs, this is where the debate's going to be going forward. So what can trustees do with respect to explicit costs? What can they do with respect to implicit costs, which is where the action's going to be? And again, trustees are pretty good at explicit, but implicit's where the direction of travel is, and that's where trustees start to find it harder. So you're starting to get into this behavioural area called salience of costs and fees. So that's really where we got to so far, and then we're starting to look at next. The next one will be out at the end of April, I think, start of May, and that's when we've asked the question, what is it you look for in your investment consultant, and what do you look for in your fund manager, which was quite interesting too.
Yeah.
And the cost and fees is just being published now.
I think one reflection, hopefully we'll have some, put your hand up if you've got any questions. So I'll just ask another question with an observation, is that, you know, when you see asset managers turning up for a pitch, it's typically the same, obviously the same asset class, pretty similar style, you know, the performance is naturally pretty good. And interestingly, when that door closes, you make a decision of one of those three. And the question is, first of all, who is it? And then how was that decision arrived at? And I guess, you know, thinking of the points that you've been making, John, it depends on the knowledge base and the confidence of that trustee board, the emotional connection, but also maybe if the consultant pitches up first and puts his thoughts over, and whether groupthink just takes over. Have you seen that? Would you agree with that to some extent?
I think you paint a very familiar scenario there, Ruston, and I think the onus is on us as a group, whether that is trustees and advisors collectively or advisors providing a framework for trustees to do by themselves. Better ways to discern difference between providers, and better ways to call out where some of the biases are being shown. One of my other kind of bias points is something called in-group bias, where folk within an affinity group see massive diversity and difference amongst themselves, but anyone from outside that group kind of paints anyone of that group as they are like this, they are exactly the same. And we get these confusions, so consultants see great diversity amongst themselves, but trustees can struggle to discern the difference between different consultants rocking up. Same fund managers see great diversity amongst themselves, but trustees can see difficulty discerning the differences. So I think we've got to work harder on pulling out those differences and providing frameworks for trustees to challenge around those points of difference.
Thanks, John. There's a question from this gentleman in the front.
Thank you very much. Is this on? Yes?
I think so.
I'm Jonathan Maiden-Smith. I'm from London Borough of Hackney. I'm a pension fund trustee. And it's a question really for both Hannah and Iain, if I may. Hannah first. When you talked about your methodology, did you combine consultants and trustees or keep them separate? And then my question for Iain, if I may, when you did your study, what was the sort of consultation base and what was the response rate that you got, please?
Okay, so we kept them completely separate. So the framework of asking the questions in the focus group, which was the initial kind of information gathering stage, we had some hypotheses about what we thought both sides might be privy to, but we approached those groups differently. So, you know, 12 people in a room having a look. And you've got to think of the things that people say. There's also body language when they make decisions. So if you talk to people about throwing rubbish away, they'll often use that motion. It's a throwing something in the bin. And then it's problematic because bins are now things that you have to post things in, but that's not what we think of when we do it. So when you're observing behaviour in a room, you can see when people struggle as well in a physical sense. So you can see, for example, all the trustees, we asked the consultants, do trustees have problems, you know, like authority, kind of in a broad sense, when we're asking the questions? And the consultants were like, yes, absolutely, they defer to the authority in the room. When we asked the trustees, they're all like, no, moved on from that question. And that's what I mean about their consensus was, as far as they were concerned, that as far as they were concerned, they didn't.
So the research really took two different parts. So one part was an online survey, and it was an online academic survey. It wasn't a marketing survey, so it took 25 minutes if you were good. So it was actually quite a big ask of people to do it. And Iain very generously, from my perspective, sent it out to, I think, around 3,000 trustees. And we got 197 usable responses. So it's actually quite a substantial base that this is coming from. You compare it to previous work, it was 40, I think.
It's only 200 responses out of 3,000. How is that a sample?
That's the way surveys work. And within that, then what we're looking at is there's good cross-sectional variation. So it's not dominated by big schemes, it's not dominated by small schemes. And again, we've got a good cross-section of member-nominated, employer-nominated, independents. So actually, in terms of trying to talk about the results, there is definitely something there where this feels more substantive than anything that's out there, more substantive than rhetoric. And actually, I'm rather happy with it thus far, and hopefully people find it interesting and valuable.
If I may just supplement that as well, and the risk of sounding defensive, and that's my apologies, but there were also a number of face-to-face interviews, qualitative interviews that took place with a range of prominent trustees across the industry. And my instinct's the same as yours, 200. But actually, if you compare it to any other surveys out there, it's substantially greater. It's very hard work to get people to commit to do a 30-minute survey, and we're pretty pleased with that response rate.
But Jonathan, you do raise an interesting point, which is how comfortable are we in revealing, you know, how we think we behave and giving something away. Any other questions, please put your hand up. But just while we're doing that and getting to the mic to the gentleman in the third row, I was just reflecting, actually, in our businesses, you'll be very much aware there's lots of Myers-Briggs, there's colour analysis, we do lots of stuff to try and understand our personalities and how we can work really well together. Question is, you know, with a trustee board and the governance we have and the responsibilities that we have, both in terms of assets and people, to what extent do we take that into the trustee boardroom? I mean, Hannah did come along to one of our away days to help us think about that. And we're going to go through some Myers-Briggs at Tesco just to help us as we make some changes on the board to understand those personalities. There's no right or wrong answer. But I just wondered, Hannah, if you could comment on that more broadly. Do you see trustee boards being reflective and thinking more in the way businesses do? Or do you think that's not something that's happening right now?
I think, obviously, it's dependent on the board. And I think what you have to look at is every society, every tiny culture, including like a tiny culture of a board, has its own kind of social norms of how people behave. And maybe it's a deference to the chair, or it's that everyone challenges, or it's that no one challenges. Yeah. Do people shout out across the table? You know, is there a lively discussion? Do you go around the room? Do you capture the input of introverts to make sure that everyone's voice is heard in turn? Because that's very important, because quite often those people don't speak out unless you take it in turns for them to have their input. Yeah. I think in terms of reflection, one of the most important things that you can do, is really valuable, is to do what's called a pre-mortem. So what you do, as a guy called Gary Klein, is you go away and before you implement a big change in the portfolio, you break out into groups and you say, okay, it's 12 months or 18 months from now, or if your time frame is 20 years, you say, it's that point in time, and it all went horribly wrong. You know, what did we do wrong? And so it's kind of like a disaster scenario, a bit like Ed was talking about yesterday. Yeah. And working back from that, it's like, you know, if it did all go wrong, then why? And then coming back to the room and reporting that, because that's a way to analyze a decision without actually, you know, anyone attacking it post, but before attacking it.
Thank you very much indeed. The gentleman in the third row.
Yeah, sure. I just want to ask the panel a little bit about, we've spoken a bit about this lack of cognitive diversity on trustee boards. With a kind of dwindling pool of defined benefit membership, how can we get around that challenge? Because it occurs to me that particularly on an age diversity level, you might not have a kind of intake of young trustees coming into the board.
Thank you. Iain?
Well, I think that's one of the things that comes out in the research, that there is a potential sort of capacity crunch, because I think it would be quite challenging to get somebody who's currently 20 on a DC scheme to then become a trustee in 25 years' time to manage the pensions of somebody who's considerably better off than them, and I've not got a good answer to it. But I can see it as being a problem forthcoming.
Actually, though, interestingly, we do have an opportunity through member-nominated trustees, and the question is, you know, we had a sort of shortlist of 40, but actually, what was the average age? And was the diversity, you open it up to everybody, but are we trying to encourage the right people to come forward to get that sort of diverse view? It's probably something to take away and reflect upon. Hannah, have you any observations?
Yeah, I have an opinion on this from recent interactions I've had, which is to think about, do we need a panel afresh? You know, do we need a way to bring people in to be trustees by having some kind of a structured mentoring, or have a, you know, some kind of training effectively where you can sit on a board without actually being a member of the board necessarily? And I think particularly for women who sit outside the sphere of things quite often, because when we draw up lists of people that we think would be appropriate to do a job, we tend to look at the people who already do it. And so unconsciously, if everyone who sits on your trustee board is male and has a certain type of education, a certain type of background, or, you know, came from finance, you might think that that's an ideal list of traits. Instead of drawing those up afresh and then saying, what are the ideal list of traits? What is a good mix across a board? What do we need a mix of? And then trying to resource against that rather than just look at what you already have.
Thank you. The lady just there on the edge. Could you just say who you are and where you're from, if you wouldn't mind? Thank you.
Rachel Croft, Independent Trustee Services. Very interested in the checklist and the particular types of bias that you've identified and recognised many of them. Have you yet drawn any conclusions as to why those biases exist in a trustee context?
I think we're all privy to all of these biases all of the time. It's just a way of holding up a mirror. So not every trustee was guilty of all six, but when we looked at the makeup of the population in aggregate, we could see that those were the ones that were coming through strongest, and therefore those are the ones that we probably needed to address with the checklist on behaviour. individually, you know, you'll all have quirks. And it's just about looking around the room and thinking about it. If you have the checklist and you've got a copy, it's just having to think about, it's almost like, I'm trying to not use a swear word that goes with this, but bingo of a kind, which is almost to sit in the room and make it fun and make it a challenge, so that if you catch someone doing something that appears to be, you know, stamping down their authority or saying, we've always done it this way, you know, we've had this manager for 3 years, I was involved in this investment decision in the beginning, you know, I know these guys forever, that you listen to what they say and take it and have a look at what they could be applying and maybe call them out on it.
I think that's a good point. I mean, challenge can be made in a couple of ways. One is that you can't be bothered or it feels too confrontational, so you never make the challenge and that's bad. And another is that it becomes across as, yeah, kind of too argumentative and that also feels bad. So this actually creates a platform for a fun and engaging way to challenge.
Thank you. I think we've got time for one last question. Closest one to the mic. And then can we please answer it as swiftly as possible so we don't delay the next session?
Simon Lavelle from Capital Group. I've got two closely related questions from the perspective of an asset manager. So be interested in any thoughts on what asset managers can do practically to help mitigate these biases in their role in this, you know, with trustees and with consultants. And then secondly, specifically as it relates to the manager selection process, my observation over the years is that there is zero correlation between a portfolio manager's investment ability and their presentational ability, and yet they're often judged on their presentational ability. And so how can that be controlled for?
I have a few on that, but Hannah, do you want to?
really quickly, the choice architecture that you put in front of people affects what they choose. So the most popular choice of coffee in every country is medium, no matter what that size is. And that affects fund managers when they're putting forward their portfolio. Like, so if it's you and you're putting forward a pitch, you kind of want to be in the middle of the mandates. That's quite valuable for you. And the consultants are guilty of picking those three options that go in front of you. And then, sorry, the second aspect?
Well, really, in terms of, I think what they're saying is the asset managers get selected.
On
their presentational skills, but actually they're fund managers. That's not their core skill set.
I have a horrible piece of information on this that came out in the behavioural conference last year, which is, comes from entrepreneurs pitching for investment, and there was no difference for women in terms of their pitching, whether they won or not. They lost out to men overwhelmingly, even when the script was exactly the same, they said the same thing. Men won more than women. It didn't matter whether the woman was attractive or not, but it really mattered for the man. And it turned out that a good-looking man won the pitch more often than a non-good-looking man. So I'll wrap up by saying, maybe employ more attractive fund managers or let the really cute sales guy pitch.
Iain, 10 seconds.
I think from my side, it's about understanding that the person speaking to you is trying to sell something to you. So from the trustee point of view, probably a higher degree of cynicism and sort of try to check your biases. The status quo thing is quite a hard one to shift, and again, the natural risk aversion that people have to doing things slightly differently, that's a really hard thing to manage. So just being aware of these things should, in theory, get to better decisions.
And Hannah's evidence-based stuff has just completely blown my theory, which I thought it was about content, open, honesty, relating to the scheme. Hey, thank you. Anyway, I'd just like to wrap up and say thank you very, very much indeed for all your questions. I think we could continue this for a very long time. Please come along to Aon Stand, which I think is number 31. You can have a copy of the research that Iain and his team have done. And obviously we can pick up that conversation. I'm sure there's the odd drink available as well. So John, Hannah, Iain, thank you very much indeed. And let's thank them in the usual way.